Okay, good afternoon, everyone. This is Marko Dragic from CMC. Welcome to CMC webinar series, and thanks for joining us. Today, we are very pleased to host research groups from University of Toronto, led by Dr. Sorin Voinescu and Dr. Tony Carson. Just to provide a little bit context of this webinar, CMC recently introduced 28-nanometer fully depleted SOI technology to our portfolio. And over the last year, through a collaborative project supported by the CMC Solution Program, we've been working with the researchers from the University of Toronto on a test chip in this technology. So the main motivation for this project was to pipe clean the flow sign-off process to characterize devices and to produce results in a form of design scripts, reports that can help other researchers within NDN to faster adopt technology and accelerate their learning curve. So today's webinar is part of this effort, and we will discuss what has been learned through this project, and we'll have two presentations in this 1 hour. So each presentation will follow by a 5-minute question and answer period. With this, I'm going to turn it over to our first presenters today. It's Sorin Voinescu and Stefan Shopov from University of Toronto.
Hello, can anybody hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Sorin.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Sorin speaking. Stefan is here with me. He's camera shy, so I'm going to do the presentation, but he's here to correct me.
I just want to make sure that we can. I just want to make sure that we can see your slides.
Can you?
No, you just have to click share my screen.
I thought I'm in sharing mode all the time.
Yeah.
Are we supposed to see them too, or?
So you cannot see my screen?
I cannot.
Well, I thought I asked you that to check that before. That's where would I click on share my slides?
So
share my desktop. Can you see it now?
Okay, here we are, yes.
All right, okay. And by the way, I'm doing this in Linux. All right, so I'm going to talk about characterization of the high frequency performance of 28 nanometer ultra thin body and box fully depleted SOI MOSFETs as a function of back gate bias. This is work done by Stefan. I'm just presenting. So here's the outline. So I'm going to briefly go over the technology features. We're going to then go through the measured transistor performance, both DC and high frequency, and briefly go over a circuit demonstrator, which will show how well the models match what we design, and also we wanted to push the boundary of what this technology can do and compare with other technologies. All right. So as I mentioned, first and foremost, we wanted to compare the millimeter wave performance of this technology with 28 nanometer LPCMOS. We did a previous test chip about 2 years ago in 28 nanometer LPCMOS, also through CMC. And also we wanted to compare with the 55 nanometer CE by CMOS technology now under prototype from ST that we also measured in our lab here. First and foremost, we wanted to explore the unique features of this technology, something that doesn't exist in any other CMOS technology, either bulk planar or FinFET or other SOI technologies, and that's the backgate. And it, particularly the impact of the backgate bias, which acts as a second gate. So this is essentially a double gate device. You could have independent control of each gate, of each of the two gates, and we wanted to see the impact on analog and high frequency performance, especially on transconductance, maximum frequency of our maximum available gain. And as a circuit demonstrator, which is kind of a separate project, We were looking at a fiber optic transceiver array, so we wanted to see how high we can push the data rate, the TIA sensitivity, and this is an array targeted at silicon photonics modulators that require more than 3 volts peak-to-peak swing, so it incorporates a large swing driver. We wanted to see how that works at very high data rates. And we also wanted to explore transceiver lane isolation in measurements because three lanes are included on this die and all the designs are single-ended and the isolation between lanes was one concern. All right, so this slide shows the cross-section through the device. So you could see here that there are actually there are four types of devices that are available in this technology. You can have N-well and P-wells under or separately biased and controlled N-wells and P-wells under each of the two devices, N-MOS or P-MOS, so that allows for a lot of flexibility. The technology features a thin body that's 7 nanometer thick. I think that's public, and that's what I'm talking about it. It's about the same, for those who are interested in FinFETs, it's about the same width as the, or thickness as the width of the fin in Intel's 22 nanometer FDSOI technology. Physical length is 24 nanometer, which is the shortest 28 nanometer technology reported to date. The box is 25 nanometer thick, so it's thin enough that the bias on the N-well or P-well can significantly change the threshold voltage, so that means that you do not have to have dedicated devices with low threshold or standard threshold and high threshold. You can adjust the threshold essentially to whatever you wish by biasing the backgate. Okay, so let me go to the next slide, which shows how we do the layout of the test structures. We only had 0.5 by 1 millimeter available, so there wasn't much room for test structures. As you can see on the left, that's the die photograph, so there's a long transmission line at the bottom that's about
300 microns long.
Yeah, 330 or something.
And then we have a short transmission line, one of the four structures in the middle, that's approximately 100 micron long. And then we have an NMOS. And the PMOS, both with 0.5 micron gate length and single gate contact. And then we have another NMOS double gate contact with 0.78 micron finger width, 28 fingers. So you see on the right-hand side the layout of the double gate contact and single gate contact layouts. They are similar layouts, or I should say identical to the ones we did in 28 nanometer LP CMOS, as well as what we do in other technology nodes, so that we can compare apples for apples. The other thing important here, you see on the, again on the die photo on the left, you see a pad towards the top and a pad at the bottom. Those are used for backgate bias. So we control the P-well from one of them and the N-well from the other one. So this way we can measure the high frequency performance and the DC characteristics and analog performance as a function of back gate bias separately for the NMOS and the PMOS. So the structures that we designed, they all have N-well under the NMOS FET and P-well under the PMOS FET. So by forward biasing forward biasing the N well, you essentially increase the current, as you will see in the NMOS, and the same goes for the PMOS by forward biasing the P well. And essentially you increase conductance and you decrease the threshold voltage for the NMOS and increase the threshold voltage for the PMOS. All right, so slide six shows the measured transconductance characteristics of the PMOS and the NMOS. These are the devices with 0.5 micron finger width, so they're identical geometry. And you see them here, the curves are as a function of the back gate bias. And as the gate is, as the back gate is forward bias, as the primary gate, you reduce the threshold voltage, so you see that the curve shifts to the left in the case of the NMOS, or to the right in the case of the PMOS. You see that we reach a peak transconductance of just above 1.5 millisiemens per micron in the NMOS case, at around 0.9 millisiemens per micron in the PMOS case. And as you make, as you reverse bias the back gate, you can get a flatter response of the transconductance as a function of VGS. So essentially, you move the threshold voltage below zero, and you get less than 15% variation in the transconductance for the entire range of gate source voltages, which is ideal if you want very linear transistors in power amplifiers or drivers. You pay a little bit of price in the peak transconductance, but you get a very flat response, which is ideal for analog applications. Now, a comparison here with what we measured in LP CMOS, same foundry, same transistor layout. The transconductance there for the NMOS was the same, 1.5 millisiemens per micron. For the PMOS, it was worse. So we have significant improvement in the PMOSFETs, and that's due to the strain induced, compressive strain that's induced by the bottom oxide layer in the P-channel device, which improves the mobility of holes. And in general, at least in the DC characteristics and high-frequency characteristics, it's the PMOS that has significantly improved performance over the PMOS in the LP CMOS technology. Next slide shows the cutoff frequency, and you could see, again, same transistors, same back bias variation, so you could see that the transconductance curves closely follow the, the cutoff frequency curves closely follow the transconductance curves. One thing that is important to mention here, all these measurements, all the high frequency measurements, include the parasitics of all the metallization on top of the device, unlike what's presented in the ITRS roadmap. We do not de-embed any of the metal on top of the device. So this is the true circuit performance of the device, and that's what we do in all the comparison with any other technology and also with silicon germanium HBT. So this is the true circuit performance, not an artificial performance that you never get in reality because all the parasitics of the metallization on top of the transistor is removed down to metal one. That's what ITRS does. Now, again, in simulation, if you do that, you essentially get about 50% to 100% faster device performance than when you extract the layout with the metal parasitics, just to put things in perspective. So you see that we get a transconductor, a peak transconductance of around 300 gigahertz for the NMOSFET and about 195 for the PMOSFET. And again, as you make the threshold negative in the case of the NMOSFET or positive for the PMOSFET, you get flat transconductance characteristics over the entire FT cutoff frequency characteristics for the entire VGS range where the device is allowed to be biased. Now, maximum allowed voltage in this technology is 1 volt. This slide shows the measured maximum available gain at 60 gigahertz, again for the same devices. Again, you see the same type of behavior, and you get a maximum available gain about 10.5 dB for this device, which is single gate contact for the NMOS, and around 8 dB for the PMOS. Now, how do these devices compare in terms of high frequency performance with other MOSFET devices with similar layout and all the parasitic metals? included and designed by us with the same layout and measured by us in the same setup. So what you see here on the left-hand side, you see the cutoff frequency of N MOSFETs in different technology nodes. These are technologies from TSMC, ST, JAZZ, IBM, and a silicon germanium HBT from ST in this new BiCMOS 55 process. So you see that the peak FT current density remains approximately the same in all these technology nodes, different foundries, different device structures. And you see that the cutoff frequency has continued to improve. And FDSOI has the highest cutoff frequency to date of around 300 gigahertz. It's about 15% better than that of LP, 28 nanometer SOI. We are not sure if the improvement is due to lower parasitic capacitance or to the fact that the gate length is shorter, 24 as opposed to 28 nanometers. So that's not very clear. But it is faster. And you see that it's still slower than this 55 nanometer BiCMOS HBT with feature size of 100 nanometer emitter width. Now, on the right-hand side, you have FMAX, and that's where we see a consistent saturation of the FMAX of all N-channel MOSFETs from all foundries, whether they are SOI, FDSOI, LP. Starting from around the 65 nanometer node, there's hardly any improvement in FMAX. That's because 28 nanometer, whether planar or SOI FD, has very poor gate resistance, even though this is metal gate. But the metal gate resistance is actually very high, and that's what degrades at max. And it's about 80% lower than that of a silicon germanium HBT. Now, if we look at PMOS scaling, interesting, if you look at ST, again, across technology nodes, maybe fewer nodes, see that the LP planar CMOS from ST actually was slower than the 45 nanometer SOI from IBM, and that's because IBM, like Intel, put a lot of strain in the PMOS FET because they want fast digital circuits with CMOS inverters where the PMOS is almost as fast as the NMOS. All the other foundries don't bother to do that because their technologies are usually dedicated to RF, and the logic does not have to be as fast. They are concerned more with cost and power consumption. But the FDSOI, because of the strain in the channel, is faster than IBM's 45 nanometer SOI. So. Today, this is the fastest CMOS process we've seen, and that including all the metal parasitics, because the PMOS FET is also very good. So it reaches an FT of almost 200 gigahertz. On the right-hand side, you see the FMAX for the PMOS FET, and again, you see saturation. This is shown there for comparison, a 55 nanometer PMOS FET in the BiCMOS 55 process. So you see it has actually better FMAX than what we measure in LP and FDSOI, and they're both smaller than the FMAX that we measure in IBM's 45 nanometer SOI PMOS FETs. Again, there, because the gate is wider, the gate resistance is smaller, and you get I have max, so gate resistance is fundamental here, and it's not going to get better. So this is the circuit demonstrator, slide 11. This is the unpublished work, so that's why we're not showing you the schematic, and it's a different project. So what we have here is a 3X transceiver array. It's a receiver and transmitter, three channels, identical channels. It's a very low noise transimpedance amplifier input receiver, and a very large swing over 4-volt peak-to-peak stack CMOS inverter output stage. And you see on the right the die photograph, the three channels flip chip, 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter. here in slide 12, you see the measured S parameters of one of the lanes as well as the crosstalk between the two lanes. All right. So at the top, you see the single channel gain, S21 as a function of frequency, with solid lines and symbol is the measurement, with dashed line is the extracted layout simulation. Then with red, you see the saturated S21, when the essentially what that means is that if we apply, let's say, minus 10 dBm of input power in the S parameter measurements, the circuit is already saturated, so the gain flattens out, and your bandwidth becomes larger, but of course you get less gain. This is relevant here because that's how the circuit operates in transmit mode. When you apply, let's say, more than 40 millivolts peak-to-peak at the input of the transceiver. And then at the bottom, you see in blue, S11, measurements and simulations. It's better than minus 8 all the way to 60 gig. And then you also see in brownish, light brown, the channel-to-channel isolation. So you see that so this is measured with both channels turned on between channel 2 and channel 1. Both are biased, so the channel 1 to channel 1 output has a gain of about 40 dB, and what you see here is the gain from channel 1 to channel 2 being approximately less than minus 20 dB. So we get better than 40 dB isolation all the way to about 50 gigahertz. On the right-hand side, you have the measurement of the noise figure in 50 ohm of one transceiver lane at different drain biases. We went up to 1.1 volt. That's on the supply, the sum voltage drop between the supply and the actual pad on the die. By the way, all the measurements that we're talking about here are all on wafer. And include not these measurements, which are de-embedded, but the rest of the large signal measurements that you'll see include the cable, probe, and interconnect loss and pads and everything. So nothing is de-embedded. So you see that the noise figure is very sensitive to the supply voltage. The higher the supply voltage, the better the noise figure. This is not different from what we see in other technologies. We get a noise figure of around 9.5 dB all the way to 26 gigahertz, which is the range of the equipment that we have in the lab for measuring noise figure. So again, this is an entire transceiver lane, not just the TIA input stage. That will have a little bit less, a lower noise figure. And it compares very well with what we measured in a similar TIA only in IBM's 45 nanometer SOI process, except that this one has broader band. This slide shows the eye diagram measurements measured in receiver mode, and by that we mean that we apply a very small signal at the input. This is at 40 gigabit with a PRBS31 sequence, so it's good for long-haul fiber applications. So with 10 millivolts peak-to-peak input, we get pretty nice eye diagrams at 40 gigabit per second, and you see that the output swing for 10 millivolts input is about 800 millivolts peak to peak. You can read it here, which is a record for anything that has ever been published in CMOS. Both the sensitivity and the swing that you get. Here you see the transmitter eye measurements again at 40 gigabit per second with a PRBS31. We have 4 volts peak-to-peak output swing. You can see here that this is measured on wafer with 1,600 readings. So you see the jitter filling in because we have so many readings, but the eye is still nicely open with 4 volts peak-to-peak swing at 40 gigabit per second, which is again a record for any silicon technology. As far as I know, there's not even a Sigi driver that has this kind of swing at 40 gigabit per second. What else did I want to say here, I guess, for now? Oh, the input signal applied to the TIA input is 40 millivolts in this case. So we apply 40 millivolts at the input, peak to peak, and we get 4 volts peak to peak at the output, which confirms the small signal measurements, about 40 dB gain. again, this is a record for any silicon circuit at this frequency. So to summarize, the FT transconductance, output conductance, I haven't shown you that. I have backup slides to prove it. And MSG have improved over LP 28 nanometer CMOS. Fmax is the same or worse than in 55 nanometer CMOS. And that's because of gate resistance, although we have lower capacitances than we have in 28 LP CMOS. Higher sensitivity of any 40 gigabit CMOS transceiver reported to date, and the largest swing driver in any silicon technology operating at 40 gigabit has been accomplished. And we get reasonably good agreement between measurements and simulation after layout extraction. And I'd like to acknowledge CMC for fabrication and also for funding the test structure chip. Also, there was some funding from the Cannot Fund. And also to thank Professor Joyce Kuhn and Georgia Electriades for the equipment. They loaned us some equipment that we used to characterize these transistors and transceiver. And also discussions with Andrea Catlin and Patrick Auger from ST on the technology. They helped us with a conference call in understanding the technology before tape out. Yaro Pristupa for CAT support, and CMC again for CAT tools. And also acknowledge Integran for EMX software. We simulate everything using their software in terms of interconnect and inductors. And also some funding from NSERC and TFI for the equipment that we used. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, great. Thanks, Soren. I guess we have a few minutes for questions. So in order to ask the question from the audience, please unmute your line by pressing star 7.
Hello?
Yes?
This is Chris Williams from Concord University. I just was wondering if you could maybe say a few words on if there's any other schools that are doing this, and if you know if the models have been proven to work, and can you say anything about the models at this point?
I don't know if there are, but I'm sure there was some Berkeley tape-out directly through ST in this technology. Yes, actually when Rabbi was here 2 or 3 weeks ago, he said that their circuit failed in the first tape-out, but that was before this tape-out, I think. It was an even earlier tape-out than the one offered through CMC. So usually Berkeley gets on the ST chips before we do in CMOS, maybe not in BiCMOS. For models, this is what we're showing here. So the dashed lines are simulation results after extraction. And the solid lines are measurements. So it's reasonably good agreement. The models are always a little bit more optimistic than what we measure. But my experience, first and foremost, we do not model everything that is in the circuit. Never been able to do that. So at these frequencies, you cannot really extract the whole chip. There's things that can be explained that are actually not captured in simulation, and that's not the, let's say, the founding model fault, is the circuit designer fault.
Okay, thanks. We have one more minute if there are any other questions for Soren.
If there's no one else, I'd like to ask one more question.
Sure, please go ahead.
I'm just wondering, in this technology, do you have a PAD library and the standard cell libraries for the PDK?
The standard cell library is available in the technology as well as PAD library.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Okay, all right. Thanks, Soren and Stefan. I think we are going to move on with the next presentation. So, Krista, if you can take control right now.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay.
All right, is that visible to everyone?
Yes, it is okay now.
Yep. Okay, great. So thanks very much to CMC for this opportunity. I'm just going to go through a little bit of background at the start of the presentation on our research on high-performance chip-to-chip communication here at the University of Toronto. And I'll take care of that myself. And then I'll hand that over to the real stars here, my PhD students, Shan Sharamian, will present something from a chip he did with an IAR infinite impulse response decision feedback equalizer in the FDSOI technology. And then Behzad Dalaghi Jadid, another PhD candidate, will go over his die-to-die link transceiver in the same technology. So a lot of high-end computing and networking systems look something like this on the inside, a backplane and multiple daughter cards connected to it via connectors. The ASICs on each of these daughter cards are separated by over 30 dB of loss through the daughter boards themselves and numerous discontinuities in the link due to the IC packaging and the board-to-board connectors that are shown here. So for these types of applications, the good thing is that the backplane and interconnect cost is low because it's just using conventional printed circuit board manufacturing technologies. But the signal integrity is a challenge. As we trend towards higher data rates, simple NRZ signaling is insufficient, so we see the standards trending towards increased use of complex equalization, modulation, and even forward error correction. And these are best handled by DSP-based transceivers. That's why in our lab we've been doing research on the analog-to-digital converters that are required at the front end of such DSP-based receivers. Shown here are just a couple of dive photos. The first one on the left here was presented recently at ISCAS in May 2014 that shows a clock distribution technique for a 2.5 gigahertz flash A to D. And on the right, more recently, was an 80-way time-interleaved SAR ADC, which we presented at the European Solid State Circuits Conference just this past September. So I'll refer you to those for a little bit more info on that work that we're doing. In both cases, we're really focused on the clocking of such large high-speed ADDs. But another approach that people are taking to mitigate the channel losses and discontinuities in such links is to try to embed optical waveguides or optical fibers into the interconnect fabric. So shown here are the optical waveguides and fibers in red, replacing the copper-based printed circuit board interconnect. The use of optical fiber for these applications eliminates crosstalk, which is a really significant limitation when trying to make these systems very dense, and also eliminates skin effect, dielectric, frequency-dependent losses along the link. So the signal integrity is greatly improved, but the main limitations on such systems are really the power consumption, cost, and packaging of the integrated circuit alongside the optoelectronics, the lasers, and the photodiodes. Picture on the right is an example of a real system that uses this type of technology. Each of those short orange cables are actually 72 optical fibers bundled together, and each of those optical fibers can carry 10 or even 40 gigabits per second of traffic each. So, to have 72 of those bundled so tightly, try doing that with copper wires. That's the really sort of enabling thing about the use of optics for this application. But to address the power consumption and cost issues, so we've been doing work in our lab on VCSEL-based links. VCSELs are the most inexpensive type of lasers for these applications, so they're preferred for high-density interconnect. Because the lasers are vertical cavity surface emitting lasers, they can be tested at the wafer level on that, and also their packaging is simplified, so that really addresses the cost issue. So just shown here quickly are a couple dye photos on the left of a laser driver connected by a bond wire directly to a VCSEL, and then the eye diagram here is an optical eye diagram capturing the light signal coming off the VCSEL at 20 gigabits per second. Some of the details are being omitted here because, again, this is as yet unpublished. On the right is a receiver, both of these chips in the same 65 nanometer CMOS technology that we accessed through CMC, and the results on the right are just the eye diagram at 10 gigabits per second. Focus on that chip was actually very, very low power, so it's consuming only a couple milliwatts there. So that's work we're doing in that direction as well. But another sort of related application or direction in this field is to try and replace the main source of discontinuity and loss along the links, which are these right angle daughter card backplane connectors, replace them with pass-through coaxial cable connectors that allow the high-speed signals to be carried from one daughter card to the other along microcoax, which exhibits greatly improved signal integrity. And so we're starting to see systems like this emerge as well. At the same time, of course, within each daughter card, there's a need for some high-speed chip-to-chip interconnect as well. So shown here, for example, are these two green packages on one daughter card. One may be an ASIC, another may be memory, and they're separated by several inches of printed circuit board trace, but no major discontinuities. And in both of these types of links, both the coax backplane replacement link as well as the chip-to-chip link within a board, we expect to see modest loss, perhaps 15 to 25 dB of loss at the Nyquist rate. And so, therefore, the objective is to develop transceivers with much lower power consumption than what we see for the traditional backplane links. So this application is really the focus of the IAR DFE that's going to be presented by Cheyenne in the second part of the presentation. So I'll leave the details there. But it's for these modest losses and targeting really low power. And finally, you can think of the final evolution of this this kind of approach is to re-engineer the interconnect link itself. In some cases, the two dies that are required huge interconnect bandwidth between them can actually be co-located, but can't be integrated in the same technology. This won't always be the case. When it's two ASICs on two separate daughter cards, all the other technologies that we've been talking about will still be needed. But if, for example, you have a large digital ASIC and a RAM that's implemented in, for example, DRAM technology, they could potentially be located on the same organic packaging or silicon interposer substrate. They can't be integrated in the same technology because the RAM's in a DRAM technology, but we can put them right next to each other and thereby really greatly mitigate the interconnect loss. So in this sort of application, the main research challenge we're trying to address is very high density, so meaning a large aggregate bandwidth per unit area on the die for the I/O transceivers, and of course very low power, so fewer picojoules per bit of energy consumption communicated between the two dies. So this sort of bench pictured on the bottom left is one example application for this, showing a hybrid memory cube on the right, which is a series of stacked DRAM dies connected, requiring very high aggregate bandwidth bus to a high-performance CPU. And again, these could be separated by as little as millimeters or fractions of a millimeter even, if using a silicon interposer technology. So this application space is the focus of the third part of the talk, is the die-to-die link transceiver and 28-nanometer FDSOI that's going to be presented by Abizad. So without any further delay, I'm going to turn it over to Cheyenne.
Thank you, Professor Carasone. So I'll be discussing our IAR DFE, and I'll start with some background. So a robust link requires some equalization and sufficient eye opening at the receiver latches. So there's a few different ways to do this. One way is to have a big transmit swing, and then the signal goes through the channel, and then to have a passive equalizer at the receiver. Now the benefits of this is that we have low receiver power since the passive equalizer doesn't burn any power. The disadvantages are that we have high transmitter power, and also that we can't indefinitely keep amplifying the signal at the transmitter since we're eventually limited by the power supply. Another way to perform this link equalization is to have a normal transmit swing, but then have a passive equalizer and receiver amplification. So the benefits would now be low transmitter power, disadvantages are high receiver power, and that we also have noise amplification in the receiver. Alternatively, those two blocks can be combined together to form a continuous time linear equalizer, where the advantages and disadvantages are the same as the previous case. Another case is to use a decision feedback equalizer, which is what we focused on in the receiver. Now, basically using the recovered data to subtract the ISI from the received signal. The advantages are that we have a low transmitter power, again, no amplification there. We also don't have any noise amplification in the receiver. The disadvantages are that the equalized data has a smaller peak-to-peak eye opening since we're always subtracting post-cursor ISI. And lastly, we can only cancel post-cursor ISI, whereas in the previous cases, both precursor and post-cursor ISI could be canceled. Looking at a few channel examples, on the left plot, we're showing the channel attenuation for one channel dominated by skin effect loss and another dominated by dielectric loss. Now, both of these channels have the same amount of loss at half the bit rate. However, if we look on the right-hand side, we can see that they have different pulse responses. The dielectric loss dominated channel has a few dominant post-cursor ISI turns, and then the tail dies down quickly. However, for the skin effect loss channel, we can see that there is more than 10 post-cursor ISI taps. So using a conventional DFT for a skin effect loss channel becomes prohibitive due to the power consumption. One way to deal with this is to use an infinite impulse response DFT. Now, essentially, this is using a continuous time filter in the DFT to cancel multiple post-cursor ISI taps at once, lowering the power consumption. And the simplest idea is to use a single time constant RC filter to basically perform that infinite impulse response feature. And on the right-hand side, we have the channel pulse response in gray, and then you can see the IIR filter output in green, canceling multiple post-cursor ISI at once. One way this can be taken further is to now use two IIR filters. So using two filters allows for more flexibility to match the channel pulse response and to cancel more post-cursor ISI. So the next natural question is to what is an optimal DFT structure to use? And we studied this and published it in TCAS 2 in 2012. So we built a system, a model for a system with K discrete time taps and N IIR filters. And then we did the study for two different channels, one backplane channel and one coax cable. So I'll only show the results for the 50-meter coax cable, but the trend is similar for the backplane channel. So on the plot on the left, we're looking at vertical eye opening on the y-axis, and the plot on the right, we're looking at peak-to-peak jitter. So these are our metrics for judging the quality of the equalized eye. On the x-axis, we're showing the number of discrete time DFT taps, where that can be adjusted from 0 all the way to 10 discrete taps. Each of the lines represents adding an additional IIR filter to the DFT. So for example, the case that's N equals 0, we don't have any IIR filters, and you can see that even with 10 discrete taps, we can't really open the eye that well. There's still a lot of jitter, and this is because it's a skin effect, it's dominated by skin effect, and there's a lot of post-cursor ISI. Now we see that for each additional IIR filter, we get an improvement, and the improvement starts to die down after two IIR filters. So what we decided to implement was a two IIR tap plus one discrete tap DFE. We implemented it in SD 28 nanometer LP process with support from CMC. That chip has been published at ESTRIC 2014, and we added the discrete time tap to eliminate the sensitivity to the loop delay, which is also discussed in that paper. The block diagram is shown here. We have a half-rate receiver, and then we have at 2-to-1 mux, which muxes the data back to full rate for the IIR filters. We're currently working on our next design in SD 28 nanometer FDSOI process. That's to be taped out on January 12th. We're using a very similar DFE with some improvements. It's running at 20 gigabits per second now using the body biasing technique. In this chip, we have the 2-to-8 demuxes designed, a custom design. And then we have demuxes down to 64, which is all synthesized logic. We also have a DFE adaptation and a digital CDR. Our main contribution to this research is the DFE adaptation, since there has been very little work done on adaptation for IIR DFEs, and those works require training sequences and also a low bit error rate to actually function properly, whereas ours doesn't require a training sequence and should be able to work starting with a high bit error rate. So as I mentioned, we also have a digital CDR that's synthesized, and then a phase rotator that adjusts the phase of the external clock phase for the latches in the half-rate DFE. Some of the features that we have on this chip, so we have the synthesized digital logic to automatically determine the DFE coefficient. The adaptation continuously runs to compensate for varying changes in the channel. The adaptation will shut off when idle patterns are transmitted, so some adaptation algorithms will diverge if a repeating pattern occurs, but our adaptation will just stop the coefficients during that time. The coefficients are transmitted off-chip to an FPGA so we can plot adaptation curves. Also, the coefficients can all be set externally so we can determine the optimality of the final coefficients of where basically our adaptation has converged to. For the digital CDR, we have a bang-bang-based phase detector which adjusts the external clock phase. And the whole thing is a phase rotator-based CDR which can handle 200 ppm of frequency offset. The tracking bandwidth is programmable, and we have a power-saving mode where we turn off phase interpolators when they're not being used. This is the chip layout in, again, 28-nanometer FDSOI process, a 1.3 millimeter by 1 millimeter. We have our inputs on the left and then transmission lines to our termination. We have our DFE, our custom 2 to 8 DMOXs, and then the digital portion, which is synthesized, which is the adaptation of digital CDR, followed up. And then our outputs are the 50-ohm drivers, and then the phase rotator is also shown the locations. At the end of the tape out, we'll be providing a digital design flow document to CMC about this process. The document will include the design synthesis and design vision from Synopsys, so setting up the standard cell libraries and the appropriate models, placing and routing of the design in Encounter from Cadence, importing the schematic and layout of the digital design back into Virtuoso Cadence, the LVS procedure for black box standard cells, and then lastly, a procedure for functional simulations, basically simulations of the synthesized Verilog and post-place and route Verilog. The document will be available at the end of January 2015. With that, I'll pass the ball off to Ben Zosh for his presentation.
Thank you, Cheyenne. Hello, everyone. As Professor Chan Carsone mentioned in his introduction, I'm working on die-to-die links. And I did a tape-out in 28-nanometer FDSOI as a part of my PhD project. So before diving into my 28-nanometer transceiver design, I want to show you the ultimate goal in this project. So here I have a picture of my system at stack-up. As you can see on the top, we have our 28-nanometer transceivers, and these two transceivers are going to be flip-chip on an interposer, which we designed in 0.35 micrometer CMOS technology. And then these two transceivers are going to communicate to each other through the channels on the interposer. The interposer is then wire bonded on our high-speed port, so we can provide the clock signals to the transceiver through our high-speed port, and also we will send the receive signal to the off-chip board to measure the bit error rate of our receivers. We also have a DC board to basically program the transceivers and provide the power signals to the transceivers. In terms of project plan, we are still waiting for our interposers to measure, so we still do not have any measurement results for the transceivers. A question that may arise when someone sees the stack-up of our system is that how we are going to attach basically the transceivers on the interposer. We are going to follow two different approaches in this project. So the first approach is shown on the left is gold spot bumping that we are going to do through QuickPack in California. And basically they are going to use regular wire bonds to create the bumps by terminating the wires on each pad. And then they are going to align the dies, and by using ultrasonic, they are going to create the attachment between the dies. The second approach is solder bumping, which we are going to do through CVI in Texas. And so basically, they are going to apply the UBM to the pads first, and then by depositing the bumps and aligning the dies, they can flow the solder to attach the two dies to each other. Here, I want to acknowledge the support that we received from CMC and especially Jian Zhang for doing the packaging part. The next piece in our system is the interposer, and we did a tape out in AMS 0.35 micrometer technology in this September. And we chose this technology because it was the cheapest technology available through CMC. On this side, we do not have any active circuits, and we just have some decoupling capacitors for our DC signals, and we also use the metal layer to create the interconnect between our two 28-nanometer dies. And as you can see, the 228 nanometer dies are going to be flip chip on this interposer die. And since we have both transmitter and receiver on each die, then we can measure the performance of our link for two different channels by using this test setup. So here I have the block diagram of our 3x30 gigabit per second transceivers in 28 nanometer tape out. As I mentioned in the previous slide, we have both transmitter and receiver on each die. So, and both transmitter and receiver are using single-ended signaling, and we have the equalization on the transmitter side to compensate for the channel loss. We have on-chip PRBS generators, and we generate the PRBS signal at a lower rate. Then we mux them up to 30 gigabits per second, and then they will be sent off by our transmitter. We also have the clock distribution circuitry on die to provide the clock to transmitter, to both transmitter and receiver. And the digital control is there for changing the settings of the transmitter and receiver, such as the equalization level or the sampling phase of the muxes and demuxes. So here you see the transceiver layout in 28 nanometer SOI. I have three transmitters on the left and three receivers on the right. So, and this will give us the ability to basically measure the crosstalk between different lanes. So by turning off and on different lanes, we can measure the crosstalk and the effect of crosstalk on our link performance. And each transmitter is occupying 75 micrometer by 75 micrometer, including the transmitter driver, P driver, multiplexer, and equalization. And each receiver is occupying 60 micrometer by 90 micrometer. And you can also see the position of clock dividers and digital controls on our layout. So after my tape out, I provided an analog design flow document to CMC along with a sample inverter design. So the analog design flow document is basically a step-by-step user guide. So the user can set up the kit and do corner simulations and Monte Carlo simulations by going through this document. They can also do LVS, DRC, and pulse layout simulation by using the script that we also provided to CMC for doing pulse layout extraction. And I want to acknowledge the help of Yaro and Cheyenne from UFD for providing this document to CMC. And we also provided a simple inverter design as part of this package, because the way that the wells should be connected in this SOI kit may be a bit confusing for the user. So by looking at this sample inverter design that is using the body biasing feature in this kit, I guess the user can figure out how they should basically connect the wells. And to get access to this document, you have to go through CMC website and submit a request. I guess that's all I had to share. So please let us know if you have any questions.
Sounds good. Thanks, Behzad and Cheyenne and Tony. I think we can open the floor for a question. We have a few minutes, so in order to ask the question, please unmute your line by pressing star 7.
Hello?
Yes?
I'm going to throw another question out there. So I'm talking to the students. Did you find there was a more or less straightforward, or how hard was it to go from the schematic to the layout? Did you find a lot of things that were not shown in the schematic? Did you see a lot of extra capacitors, resistances that showed up in the layout feature process, and did those reflect in your measured results?
Yeah, I mean, we run extraction on all of our blocks, and we do see the improvement. We do see that the circuit degrades significantly, so that's why we've also provided the extraction script to be able to run extraction. Basically, for the LP1, which is the one we have measured, that's not in this process, but we're simulating at about 12 gigabit per second extracted, and then we measured at about 10 gigabit per second.
Okay. Also, one more question regarding the insulation. I was seeing there was oxide between transistors. I was wondering, is there a number for the minimum dimensions of that for packing density?
Can you repeat this for a sec? Sorry, you cut out at the beginning there.
Oh, sorry about that. Just the insulation in between the transistors. There was a picture before with an oxide, I guess. I guess my question is the dimensions in order, is there a minimum dimensions available for that insulation between the NMOS and CMOS? This was, I guess, at the beginning, I forgot to ask that question before. Or was it with the first slide? I'm just wondering if there's a number for that.
I mean, I think it's maybe is best not to get into the detailed numbers of the design rules.
Okay.
I guess something that I have to sign NDA to get access to.
Okay, all right.
Once you go through the process of NDA, you will have access to the design rule manual, and then you will be able to see all details about the specific design rules.
All right.
Okay, great, thanks. Any other question?
Hello.
Yes, please go ahead.
I'm Andre from Montreal. I have a question, please. Regarding the LVS that you said that you have done, are you able to extract parasitic, to make parasitic extraction from by calibre from this LVS or not?
And not using calibre. We have a script that basically runs the extraction, and then we can simulate that, but not using calibre right now.
I mean, you're not using calibre even for DRC?
No, for DRC and LVS we are, but for extraction we're not.
Okay. I mean, it's your way of doing things, I would say. Yes, because I've seen mostly 28 nanometer, it's kind of, let's say, assigned to calibre procedures.
If I can jump in here, the ST design kits use TAR-RC for extraction.
Yes. Are you able to do it?
Of course, yeah. We did it in the first design.
In the first design?
Everything is extracted, and they have extracted too, as they said. Yeah. So so you use calibre for DRC and LVS, and you use TAR-RC for extraction.
Okay. But
the standard flow in all the ST design kits.
So actually, you are doing extraction from LVS by STAR-C.
After LVS.
After LVS, yeah.
After LVS, of course. After LVS, yes.
Yeah. And
okay.
Yeah, and this is all explained in the design flow document.
Okay. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks, Andre. We have 30 seconds for the last question.
Hello.
Anyone?
Ed from Concordia. I was sitting in next to Chris. I just have a question with regards to what are the server requirements if we wish to install this kit here at Concordia. I recall from the last time they were quite severe and strict.
They are. We can, here at CMC, we can provide you the document that would outline all the details of specific requirements there. You need to install it in a completely isolated environment and after the call, I'm going to follow up with you.
Okay, thank you, Mark.
Okay, all right. So, this concludes our webinar for today. Thanks, everyone, for participation, and have a great day.
Thank you, too.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.